Function words are everywhere. We're exposed to them all the time, sometimes by stealth, and you're not actually going to notice a function word. But if you were to be able to analyse them, what would it tell you about the person? Hi, I'm Chris, I'm a doctor, I've read this book, and it uses computer techniques to analyse text and spoken word to ascertain a number of interesting things, including the characteristic of the individual. Are they lying? So it looks back at some historic masterpieces such as William Shakespeare, and it also looks back at historic notable speeches from US presidents and thinks, were they actually lying? Now there's three techniques about author identification, really. That would be the tracking the rate of these function words, analysing punctuation and layout, and then the use of the obscure word. So if you think of a forensic study, thinking, did somebody write this? If they've used bizarre words frequently, or put a full stop with a few more spaces afterwards each time, it may be, in essence, their digital signature. But each of these methods used alone actually has a higher chance of identifying who the author is than just matching other writing samples. So using the power of a computer, you can actually, with much higher than chance, identify the gender and the potential age range of whoever has written this. Now, they've sampled hundreds of thousands of languages from the internet, books, blogs, conversations, and seemingly men consistently use articles at a higher rate than women. Now, an article, as you may well know, is a word that comes before a noun to show it's specific or general. As a native English speaker, I must confess I had to look that up. I don't think grammar's taught particularly well in schools, but that's completely a sidetrack. I think the education system's brilliant, thanks to all the teachers out there. However, going back to this, when you take people's sex into account, a high article usage tends to be in those people who are more organised and emotionally stable. And seemingly, men and women who habitually use a and the at higher rates tend to be more conscientious, more politically conservative, and also older. It's of note that as people age, the use of language changes. I'll tell you more about that later. All function words such as before, over, and to require a basic awareness of a speaker's location in time and space, and the ability to use them interacting with others is really a marker of basic social skills. And this is really difficult to learn if it's your second language. You may have heard about the use of the word I, or the letter I. Using it too much suggests that you're self-centered and the person is more likely to be depressed. On a side note, when I look at the YouTube subtitles, it always has I as not a capital and I have to correct them. So perhaps that's changed my use of the word I. Women tend to use first-person singular pronouns or I words more than men. And people's pronouns track their focus of attention. And if somebody's actually anxious or self-aware, in pain or depressed, they may pay more attention to themselves rather than others. And this research from this book suggests that women on average are actually more self-aware and self-focused than men. And this difference in the use of I words between men and women isn't subtle. And in natural conversations, women tend to use more I words than men. Once again, this is me just summarising a book. This isn't necessarily what I think, but it did seem to be fairly credible, and feel free to check it out yourselves. Men and women use first-person plural words, or we words, interestingly, about the same rate. And most of the time, this means that us, or you, or I. But there's the royal we, of course. And there's also the political, ambiguous we. And also no difference in positive emotion words was actually noted between men and women. However, women use cognitive words more than men. Cognitive words are words that reflect different ways of thinking and include words that tap insight, understand, know, think, casual thinking, because, reason, rationale, and related dimensions. And it may be that social words are often referred to how human beings relate to each other, and perhaps women talk about that more than men do. And if you have the kind of super male, they'll talk about lots of articles, prepositions, and that's when a word is governing, usually preceding a noun or a pronoun in relation to something else. And men tend to use very few pronouns, social words or cognitive words. And so this, if you think of it as women speaking about people, men speaking about equipment more. I mentioned that with age our language changes, and it tends to become more positive. Older people often used function words more as if they're like how a man would, and younger people tend to speak more how a woman would. And these patterns seemingly are true across different cultures, languages, and even different points in time, because we've obviously got old texts that we can study and draw lessons from. And interestingly, it's not that women are starting to talk more like men and men are just the same with age. Rather, men and women usually have parallel changes. So for example, from the ages from 8 to 14, about 19% of girls' words are pronouns, compared to 17% for boys. By the time the person becomes age 70, this drops to about 15% for women and 12% for men. So you can see that both have dropped. They don't give the number to be able to have any meaningful statistical analysis there, but they've implied the number is high, so there would be significant changes, and both dropping and comparing the cohorts of male and women. Let's talk about analytical thinking, and this identifies people who would actually, how they would understand the world. And if somebody's an analytical thinker, they're often making distinctions. These distinctions could be between what people did or what they didn't do, which part of the test they passed and which part of the test they failed. Words that contribute to analytical thinking include exclusives, but, without, except, negations, such as no, not, never, causal words, not casual words, because, reason, effect, insight words, you know, the meaning, tentative words, maybe, perhaps, certainty, absolutely, always, and quantifiers, some, many, greater. And people who make distinctions in speaking and writing make higher grades in college, and perhaps that's not a surprising thing, but they tend to be also more honest and more open to new experiences. And those who read more and often have more complex views of themselves, perhaps those are the people who have low levels of analytical thinking. Narrative thinking are people who are often portrayed. If you're a narrative thinker, you'll be a storyteller. And often you can't control yourselves. From a simple language perspective, the function words that generally reveal storytelling involve people, which means the use of personal pronouns of all types, especially third-person pronouns, past tense verbs, and conjunctions. especially words such as with and together. People who score high on narrative thinking tend to have better social skills, more friends, and rate themselves as more outgoing. It's of note, people's thinking styles fluctuate depending on who they're with, what they're doing, and how they feel about themselves at that particular moment in time. And when somebody changes a conversation direction, just take note, it's a powerful marker of what is on his or her mind. And when you're expressing true beliefs, people often use larger, longer, bigger words and relied on more complex sentences. The arguments often tended to be more nuanced and less emotional. And that's when they've studied people who are, they know are lying. And it's particularly interesting that there was a relatively heavy use of exclusive words when people are telling the truth. Exclusive words would be making a distinction between what one category is and what isn't. You may think about reflective writing. At times this can be useful for people who have had to overcome trauma and reflect about it. It's only good, according to this book, if that person then gives their true personal thoughts about the incident. If they're just putting it matter of fact, statement of fact, it won't be as beneficial to them. So, functional words and function words can distinguish, if you look at advertising online, honest and deceptive ads. And there's sometimes difference in the content of these words, and this book's worth looking at for some of the dating profiles that they analyse. And people who are dishonest about their profiles tended to shift their focus of their self-description away from that particular sensitive topic. So, for example, women and men who lied about their weight were less likely to mention anything about food, restaurants, or eating. In addition, those with pictures that were deceptive tended to focus on topics of work and achievement that tried to build up their status and downplayed their physical appearance. Lying can be hard to detect. You don't need me to tell you that. However, with a computer and in retrospect, lies can be found up to 75% of the time. The main difficulty is it relies on a baseline knowledge that person was not telling the truth, and you don't have that when somebody's lying. That's where the statements about US presidents were interesting to analyze about wars in Iraq, for example. But if you have three statements, which one do you think is most likely to be true? I finished my homework, but the dog ate it. That's statement number one. Statement number two, I had finished the homework, but the dog must have eaten it. Or statement number three, the homework was finished, but must have been eaten by the dog. However, the first excuse is far more likely to be true because it includes two past tense verbs that indicate the actions were specific and were completely finished. The second excuse relies on five verbs that hint that the actions were not completed, and with the word must, may not even have happened. And the third person's excuse is the most dubious of all three. Six verbs, past tense, and not a single I word. So as these examples attest, when somebody doesn't directly answer your question, there's a good chance that they're hiding something, no matter how earnest they may sound. LSM. For this book, that means language style matching. And it's to get a sense of how in sync two people are. And what you can do is look at the rate of personal pronouns that each individual uses and match them on a scale to see how perfect the fit is. Like many scales, it's scored between 0 and 1.00. And if people were in perfect function word harmony, then they would get a 1.00. And if they were completely out of sync, it would be a 0. In reality, conversations range from about 0.6 reflecting low synchrony to 0.85 reflecting very high synchrony. And there's a great website below that I'll put in, other than my own personal website that I'll put in again. I put written summaries of books, in case that's your thing, and some other stuff. But this one, secretlifeofpronouns.com sync. And there you can add text into two different categories and see how much sync there is going on. So you could try that with emails from your boss, or perhaps your friend, lover, enemy. Your boss could obviously be any of those things as well. But with the click of a button, you'll receive feedback to show how much in sync the use of your function words are. So that may be useful, and you could say, oh well, I'm more in sync with this person than that person. But does that tell you a lot? A bit and not. It's good because it can show how much you're in sync, but that's about it. It doesn't show about the meaning of synchrony. And when language styles match, it tends to be that both people are passionate about each other, or they could hate each other. It just shows that you're really paying attention to your conversational partner, no more, no less. And in fact, if somebody is lying, they may be paying more attention, so therefore the language styles may match more. Let's talk about I and we. If you've got a team, you want everybody to be using the we word. In essence, that shows that you're all bought into the same thing. And the longer people actually know each other and talk to each other, they start to use more we words and less I words. And, you know, it shows that you're kind of, they're starting to let the guard down, accepting each other. And this pattern of increasing we words and decreasing I words, it often emerges across many groups. And you could track that if you're particularly sad, or if you're lucky enough to get paid to do that and get a computer to do it for you. But let's end with this. Just think, over time, if you've got a group and you are being threatened, your outside identity or your group identity needs to increase to overcome the outside challenges. That's when, if you're using we words, you'll find that the group is strong. So, what can I say? Well, we all hope you've enjoyed that, and I'll see you next time. Take care.